Welcome back to our exploration of the Millennium Prize Problems. Last time, we unraveled the mystery behind these million-dollar mathematical challenges and delved into the Riemann hypothesis, a problem that suggests a special pattern in how prime numbers are spaced, linked to an equation called the Riemann zeta function. Today, we're turning our attention to what some have called the most difficult math problem you've never heard of, the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer Conjecture.
Those are some bold words, the most difficult. You're setting quite the stage.
This conjecture is so complex since it ties together some fairly advanced ideas from algebra, geometry, and number theory together. The Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture deals with elliptic curves, mathematical shapes that are both strikingly beautiful and incredibly useful. It proposes that a global property, the number of rational solutions to these curves, can be determined by local data, patterns hidden in the points modulo prime numbers.
Local data controlling the global picture? It sounds almost poetic. But what are these points modulo primes?
Glad you asked, and we will get into this in more detail later. It's not as intimidating as it sounds. For now, imagine you're dividing numbers by a prime, say 7, and only caring about the remainders. 0 through 6, that's modular arithmetic. Now, apply this concept to the points on an elliptic curve. By studying how these points behave under such filters, we gather local snapshots that, remarkably, help us understand the whole curve.
So we're piecing together a mosaic from tiny fragments. Why should we care about this mosaic, though? What's at stake here?
Because elliptic curves aren't just mathematical shape, but the backbone of modern encryption. Your online banking, secure emails, even cryptocurrency, all of it relies on elliptic curves. Cracking this conjecture could transform how we secure information and potentially even unveil new technological breakthroughs. And beyond the practical applications, this conjecture embodies the interconnected nature of mathematics. It's a bridge linking number theory, geometry, and analysis, showing how diverse fields illuminate one another.
And it's a millennium problem, which puts it in rarefied air.
Absolutely. The Clay Mathematics Institute chose it for its depth, complexity, and far-reaching implications. Decades of work has gone into it, yet a complete proof remains just out of reach. That's what makes it irresistible and maddening. Let's dive into it. Let's rewind to the 1960s. Cambridge University, Bryan Birch and Peter Swinnerton-Dyer were armed with one of the earliest computers, the EDSAC 2, and a burning curiosity about elliptic curves. They weren't trying to make history. They were just exploring patterns in mathematical data.
So those must be very early computers with, what, the processing power of a calculator?
Pretty much. The ETACA2 had 4 kilobytes of memory. That's less than your average email. But despite these limitations, they ran extensive computations on elliptic curves. What they discovered was astonishing. The number of solutions to these equations seemed to align with the behavior of a mathematical function called the L function.
So they were computational trailblazers?
Without a doubt. The rank of an elliptic curve tells us how many rational solutions it has. They discovered that this is connected to a special function called the L function, and how it behaves at a specific point, S equals 1. This observation became the foundation of the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture. Elliptic curves are not new. In fact, these shapes date back to ancient Greek geometry, and later Fermat and Euler expanded on their properties. Then Bernard Riemann, yes, of Riemann hypothesis fame, introduced L functions in the 19th century. Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer brought these threads together, adding the power of modern computation.
So their conjecture united centuries of mathematical ideas.
Precisely. As mathematician Henri Poincaré once said, Mathematics is the art of giving the same name to different things. Their work exemplified this, bridging algebra, geometry, and analysis into one elegant framework. Swinnerton-Dyer himself described their process as part systematic, part serendipitous. He famously said, "We weren't trying to formulate a grand conjecture. We were trying to make sense of the patterns we saw."
That's poetic. So for the novice that I am, can you simplify the conjecture to the extent possible? I understand it could lose some of its nuance, but this will help me see the essence of it.
Sure. Let's get to the heart of the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture, a problem that manages to be both maddeningly complex and deceptively simple. So imagine you are given an equation and you have to find the number of solutions to that equation. Sounds straightforward, right?
Sure. A brute force way to do this could be to just plug in all possible numbers and see what works.
It depends. If it's something like a linear equation, it's easy. But when you're looking at a curve, an elliptic curve, and finding all the rational solutions becomes a very different beast.
Rational solutions? You mean fractions or whole numbers?
Exactly. The Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture, or BSD conjecture for short, proposes a way to understand how many such solutions exist. The twist is in how we count. The conjecture suggests that this global question, the total number of rational solutions, is determined by local data. It's like saying that to figure out the total number of rational solutions on an elliptic curve, you can use information about how the curve behaves in smaller, simpler parts. Specifically, it's tied to how the curve behaves when you reduce it modulo prime numbers. This is where L functions come in. They're a kind of mathematical magnifying glass that reveals patterns in these reductions.
Local data predicting the global picture. Hold on, break that down for me, please. How does an L function work?
L function is a mathematical tool used to encode information about an elliptic curve in a very compact and powerful way. Think of it as a bridge that connects the shape and properties of the elliptic curve with deeper patterns in number theory. The L function of an elliptic curve is a special kind of infinite series, like a sum, built using data from the curve. It's constructed from the number of solutions, rational points, the elliptic curve has when you look at it in smaller local pieces. Specifically, modulo different prime numbers, like 2, 3, 5, and so on. Essentially, for each prime number, say p, the L function measures how the elliptic curve behaves when you only allow numbers that work modulo p. These behaviors are combined to create the L function, which captures global properties of the curve. The L function doesn't just summarize local data. It has a deep connection to the curve's rational solutions. BSD conjecture says that how the L function behaves at a specific value can tell you something profound about the elliptic curve. If the L function behaves in a certain way, it can tell us how many rational solutions the curve has. The more the L function vanishes, or equals zero, the more rational solutions exist on the curve. The conjecture claims that the rank of the elliptic curve, that is, how many independent rational solutions it has, equals the number of zeros in the L function at a specific point. This creates a surprising and elegant link between a highly abstract object, the L function, and the very concrete question of how many rational solutions exist on the curve.
Wow, I won't pretend I got all of it, but I got a sense of it. This sounded really clever, but what makes this so difficult?
Great question. First, elliptic curves are incredibly diverse. There's no one-size-fits-all approach. Second, L functions are notoriously hard to compute. They're built from infinite series, and proving they behave as expected is like trying to predict the outcome of a game where you don't know all the rules.
So it's not just hard, it's slippery.
That's one way to put it. And there's a deeper philosophical challenge. The conjecture bridges algebra, geometry, and analysis. Proving it would require uniting these fields in a way we've never quite managed before. It's as much about mathematical insight as it is about technical skill.
Where do we stand today? How much progress has there been?
While the full conjecture remains unproven, there's been significant progress. For example, in the 1980s, Benedict Gross and Don Zagier proved part of the conjecture for elliptic curves of rank 1. This was a groundbreaking result, showing that the conjecture holds in specific cases.
Rank 1. That sounds narrow. What does it mean?
It means curves with exactly one independent rational solution. Think of it as a starter kit for all other solutions. Gross and Zagier showed that the conjecture works perfectly in these scenarios. Then, Viktor Kolovagin made another leap forward in the 1990s. He developed a method using Euler systems to prove the conjecture for many more curves of rank 0 and 1. These advances laid the groundwork for modern approaches.
But higher ranks, that's where the trouble starts, right?
Exactly. The conjecture for curves of rank 2 or higher is largely uncharted territory. Mathematicians have been chipping away at it, but the tools we have today often fall short. One of the biggest challenges is understanding the mysterious Tate-Shafarovich group, a ghostly object that plays a key role in the conjecture but remains elusive.
That sounds like something out of a mathematical seance. What is it, really?
It's a measure of how rational solutions behave when viewed through all possible lenses, not just primes, but over every conceivable mathematical field. If we could pin down its properties, we'd be much closer to proving the conjecture. Some tantalizing progress has been made. Mathematicians like Andrew Wiles, who proved Fermat's last theorem, have explored connections between the conjecture and modular forms. These connections are crucial because they reveal deep structural properties of elliptic curves. His work on modularity, the idea that elliptic curves and modular forms are two sides of the same coin, has been a cornerstone for understanding the conjecture. But a complete proof remains just out of reach.
So let's pull back the curtain on why solving the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture would be such a monumental breakthrough.
Well, let's start with cryptography. You know how your online banking and email encryption depend on secure algorithms? Many of those algorithms are built on elliptic curves. They're efficient and secure, or at least they're secure because we don't fully understand elliptic curves yet. If the conjecture were solved, it could mean a revolution in cryptographic protocols. Either stronger, more elegant methods could emerge, or vulnerabilities we hadn't noticed might come to light. And it doesn't stop at cryptography. The conjecture's resolution could open up entirely new ways of solving long-standing mathematical problems in number theory, algebraic geometry, and even quantum computing. Imagine algorithms that operate faster, better, and more predictably because they're informed by deeper truths about elliptic curves. Consider blockchain technology. At its core, blockchain relies on solving cryptographic puzzles to validate transactions. If we could leverage the insights from solving the conjecture, we might develop methods that either make blockchain more efficient or, conversely, crack it wide open.
So Bitcoin could either be indestructible or obsolete?
Theoretical advances often have practical ripple effects, and elliptic curves are central to so many areas that the consequences could be profound. Solving the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture would unify fields in mathematics that have been circling one another for decades. It's a puzzle piece that could complete a much larger picture. The conjecture doesn't just solve one problem, it acts as a bridge connecting algebraic geometry, number theory, and analysis. Think of it as a Rosetta Stone for understanding the hidden structures in mathematics. Solving it would likely lead to breakthroughs in areas we can't even predict yet.
But what if it's never solved? What if this remains one of those eternal mysteries?
Jennifer, while mathematics has a long history of unsolved problems driving innovation, take Fermat's last theorem. It stood unsolved for over 350 years, but the attempts to crack it led to incredible advances in number theory and algebra. Even if the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture remains unproven, the journey to understand it could yield discoveries just as valuable.